The third issue is, what are you prioritizing? How do you see allocation issues and things? Now, as you know, every water policy talk about water use prioritization. Generally, so far in India has been that the first priority is for domestic water or drinking water, we call. Second comes agriculture, third is industry or hydropower and various other type of things which you find. Only departure was in Maharashtra, I think 2005 policy did talk about the second priority as industry over agriculture, which gave a lot of people agitated about it, and maybe a year back or something, there was a government resolution, GR, which was taken out saying that the second allocation has been, second priority has been given to agriculture. But the content, the issue here is that on paper these things do exist, but in actual planning, in actual allocation, we don't find this type of thing. In Maharashtra, we have seen that first allocation is made for domestic water, second allocation is given for industries. In fact, that has been one argument to say that the state always had second priority for industry, and whatever the residual water is allocated for agriculture. So that has been one of the way in projects, the way they have been working out allocations. Now the issue is that we need to look at prioritization, conceptualize prioritization in a very different manner if you have to engage with issues saying that drinking water is actually the first priority. Here we make a distinction between what we call a proportional prioritization and a sequential prioritization. What is the proportional prioritization? Anybody has a take? When we say water is allocated different across different sectors in a proportionate manner, what does that mean?
Certain percentage of the total
availability. Now, for example, if you design a project, then they say that, okay, 6% water is allocated for drinking water purposes. Maybe 3% of water is going for industries, and the remaining water is for, let's say, agriculture. So this is an example of a proportionate water. So in a proportionate sharing or proportionate allocation does not mean that everybody's drinking water is met and then water is given to the second water priority. So in a sequential priority, what we do is that in terms of the order of priorities, then unless, for example, if the in the sequencing it is first order priorities for drinking water, then unless everybody's drinking water needs are met, then the water does not move to a second order priority. And similarly from a second order priority to a third order priority. So in Maharashtra actually we have been arguing this. In fact, there's an interesting movement called Pani Sangharsh Manch, Lokabhimukh Pani Sangharsh Manch, which is a network of different institutions, organizations, movements and type of things. So we have been trying to articulate this type of a saying that there are certain priorities which need to be seen as a sequential prioritization. Now, for example, now needs like basic needs like drinking water. So what we are arguing is that we need to move to a system which is a combination of both sequential and proportionate system. So uses of needs like domestic water use, water for ecosystem needs, and water for livelihoods should be worked out sequentially, which means that water should not move from drinking water to other needs unless the drinking water needs are met of the people. Similarly for ecosystem needs and livelihoods. And water for other uses like commercial agriculture, industries, recreation and so on a proportionate basis, after meeting the needs mentioned in the first category. So unless we have a combination of these type of systems, to say that drinking water has the first priority actually in practice does not make much of a sense. There is also an issue of reallocation of water from, somebody was talking about Maharashtra in the first sharing and type of thing. In Maharashtra, a classical example of reallocation of water, from agriculture to industries and urban use. I think Prayas has done a study which is trying to understand what is the amount of water in the last 10 years has been reallocated from agriculture to industries, come to something about 2000 million cubic meter. Or water from about 45 to 50 projects has been now reallocated to industries. Now when we say 2000 million cubic meter of water, it means an irrigation potential of to the tune of about 3 to 4 lakh hectares. Now we are talking about, if the government over the last 10 years has been reallocating water to the tune of about 2000 million, million cubic meter, it means that we are also denying people their livelihoods who are depending on about 4 to 5 lakh hectares of land, irrigated agriculture. So if you say that if a family holds, let's say, 1 hectare irrigated land per average, we are talking about 4 to 5 lakh multiplied by 5. If you have a family size of about 5 people per family, that's the amount of people we are denying their livelihoods. Now, I'm not arguing that there should be any reallocation. It's not the case. I think reallocation issue, in what form we are doing it, and in fact there is one issue which I come back as you know, industrial water use. So we'll come back to this issue saying that how do we deal with some of these conflicting issues in the sector. In fact, I don't want to get into this table much, but in Maharashtra we have tried to work out a very detailed exercise how a different system of you know, water use prioritization can work out, and this is how we should plan ideally. So you have domestic or water, basic water, the first, which is sequential, and water for livelihoods and water for ecosystem we treat at the same level. So that is the second, which is again sequential, and water for public facilities. And onwards, then commerce, agriculture, and all, you have a different type of a dealing with the issue and things. So we have done a detailed working out the different type of water uses which has been this and how the water thing. But what happens that very often many of these uses today get conflated with domestic water use, and you don't really make distinctions of, for example, luxury water, washing vehicles and type of thing, and this water today is clubbed with what you use as a domestic water type of thing. Second, agriculture itself is a term today. You need to question or disaggregate, because in the agriculture water use, you find two sets of users. There is one set of users who use water for their basically subsistence production. They don't produce with that water anything for the market to some extent. It's basically for creating livelihoods and things. But there are also larger sections of people under the rubric of agriculture water use for commercial agriculture, where you use that water for surplus generation. So unless you disaggregate these two and say that we need to target people who are using this water for livelihood as a separate category, instead of saying agriculture as an overarching or all catch type of phrase. So these are some of the things. So we need to question the whole concept of conceptualization of the prioritization itself in terms of what should be the sequential one and what could be proportional. And some of these needs we need to disaggregate. Under the basic needs today, even water which we call luxury water, whether it's for swimming pools, I'm talking about private swimming pools. I do think that there are public facilities for swimming. Swimming is a good activity, but not each bungalow and things as a privatized type of a thing, or lawns or washing cars and business. In fact, that most of the bulk of the water under the domestic use goes into these type of uses. So we need to disaggregate that and try to, because they also have, not only in terms of allocation, it also has implications for pricing of water, which we'll come back to it when we talk about pricing. So So one way of doing is that, for example, the basic service, what we're talking about, let's say domestic use. Now, domestic use, we say that there are three types of uses which is taking place under that, other user, as you said. One is that a section of that water, a portion of that water goes into basically what we call as a lifeline component, like, for example, drinking or cooking, which you need a high quality water and you need certain type of water which goes into the system. Second is that, for example, some of the hygiene needs or washing clothes or other type of thing, which we call, let's say, lifeline plus. And the third component is what you call the luxury water, which is a third broad this one. There have been people saying that let's not have three-way classification, let's have two. One is the lifeline, and the lifeline plus is one, and the other one is. So one mechanism is that if you have a differential pricing mechanism, for example, lifeline water, I would argue that, there's an argument that it should be given free. Maybe it is 20 liters per day or 25 liters per day, or according to social cultural needs, you can define quantitatively what is there. For South Africa, it talks about 25 liters per person per day as free water today. There's a free water policy in place. So one is that at a supply side, you can have this type of regulations which are bringing, saying that you need good quality water, safe water to meet these type of needs at a very, either an affordable cost or a free water type of service. So there is a mechanism to build in that type of thing. Second is that how do you build infrastructure to cater to that? For example, you need metering for this type of thing. Unless you have metering in place, this type of quantitative measures or regulations cannot be enforced. Third is that, for example, you need a different type of conceptualization of the water infrastructure itself, even at the user end. Double systems or pipelines, for example. Now, if you have this type of thing and a pricing policy, then probably some of the recycled water can be utilized for the other domestic component, and which is maybe priced differently and things. So I think unless you have a three-way approach to this, I'm not saying it's easy to implement, it's not that. But I think we can calculate, estimate how much is the water which is available at a particular unit, whether it's a hydrological unit in terms of micro water shed or a other type of thing in terms of groundwater and surface water, and what dependability we have that water. And then you can estimate this. See, the issue is that it's not easy to do. I'm not saying that, in the present system, this is going to be done. But unless we move to incrementally to some type of system of that type, which would require even at the user end some type of resource literacy programs to understand how much water we have, what's the type of quality, how do you use it today, how do you efficiency bring in another type of things. And also with the support with policy and other type of incentivization, I don't think this type of a prioritization can work. But this gives you a handle to look at things differently. Now social movements can pick it up. I'm not saying that this whole thing will get it implemented the way it is. No. But at least even if you can bring in some semblance of saying that when you talk about water policy formulations, okay, we need to separate out water for livelihood needs are separate than water for, you know, more profit making and other type of budget in terms of, you know, commercial agriculture and things. That itself is, I would say, is a step forward. Or even in the domestic sector, if you can make at least saying that, okay, water required for your lifeline or lifeline plus need to be given more priority, it should be subsidized or it should be given as free water, and you have a different approach to tackle the luxury water, even then I would say that's a positive gain. So I would look at it from that perspective. But your concern is right, it needs much more, it's much more complex. The way things are, systems are running, probably it cannot, this, but I think we need to aim to move towards that type of system.
Yeah, hydropower is, I mean, this was a debate, I think there are also people saying that hydropower is also consumptive in certain ways, you know, type of thing. But I think in a direct sense, we can say hydropower is sort of, it's a non-consumptive use. That's how traditionally it has been this.
Because the water gets back into the system. Now, in the run-of-the-river project, so there's a debate saying that, you know, you take the water from the river and there's a dry stretch till the water comes back into the system.
Proportion use that is that if you have a river system, if you find what's the type of water flows, then only after meeting the other basic needs we need to, for example, now when you talk about hydropower, for example, you don't talk about the environment that flows at all. So unless you see that, so after meeting all that, then whatever is left over, then you can allocate or you can use that, that type of thing.